And that. Okay, so guys, here's the scoop for today. Actually, you know what? This isn't the way I want to start this. Here is the scoop for today. Looks like so. So guys, here was your first homework of the, this was the first page of the homework we graded today. And guys, I want to use this to tee up for you what we're going to do today. So the idea is this. As we've been grading these homework assignments, we've been saying some things about the way that we're grading these. And you probably remember hearing this over and over and over. But one of the things we've been saying a lot is left and right and top and bottom do not matter. The oxygen could be on the left, the hydrogen could be on the right. It doesn't matter. So guys, the question is, why doesn't it matter? Why doesn't it matter if you put these atoms top, bottom, left, and right? And guys, the answer is this, because this molecule doesn't even look like this. So let's talk about what's really going on. So guys, if you were to look at this, what does that angle appear to be? Right here, this guy right here, what's that angle? 90 degrees, a right angle, right? What's this angle right here? 90 degrees, a right angle. What's this angle right here appear to be? 180 degrees, right? Well, guys, here's the trick. There are no 90 degree angles in this molecule, and there are no 180 degree angles in this molecule. This is actually what it looks like. It's flat, it's spread out like this, and guys, do you know what these angles are? Take 360 and cut it into thirds. What do we got? 120. Guys, these are actually 120 degree angles. So guys, this is where you're going to be at the end of the day today, is you're going to be able to look at this molecule and you're going to be able to go, oh, hey, wait a second. That thing doesn't even have any 90 or 180 degree angles. This thing's got 120 degree angles. So now guys, the question is this, how on stinking earth are you supposed to be able to look at this and figure out that it actually looks at this? How are you going to make that connection? And guys, you ready? The way that you're going to be able to do this is by counting shared and lone pairs. Guys, it turns out that if you have this molecule with this number of shared and lone pairs, it has to be 120 degrees. That's why we've been having you count shared and lone pairs all along, because if you know how to look at that molecule, and if you know the number of shared and lone pairs around the central atom, that actually tells you what the angles are going to be. So how are you going to make those connections? See your notes page? Flip it over on the back. Guys, here's the decoder key. The way that you're going to be able to figure out these angles is by counting the shared and lone pairs and then finding the combination of shared and lone pairs in one of these three tables. And by finding it there, once this table is all filled out, by finding the number of shared and lone pairs for any particular molecule, you're going to be able to go, hey, yo, here's the angle and here's the name and here is what it looks like. You kind of get the idea? Okay, so guys, here's how this is going to go. In order for you to figure this out, there's three things that you've got to learn in advance. You have to learn what electron domains are. Then you've got to learn about Vesper theory. And then you've got to figure out that these domains don't all have the same size and shape. So once we've gone over these three ideas, we're going to jump onto the back. We're going to bring all these ideas together, figure out these tables, and then you'll be able to decode this stuff. You get the idea? Hi. Thank you. All right. So, guys, with all that said, we're now ready to dig into the notes and get started. So, guys, the first part of this is just going to be secretarial. You're going to be taking notes, figuring things out, putting all this together, and then we're going to flip it over and start thinking about what these really look like. So, you guys ready to go? Here we go. First thing first, guys, don't write any of this down. So this is sort of teeing up the ball today. So guys, today, up until this point, what we've done is we've drawn two-dimensional Lewis dot structures. And guys, Lewis dot structures are incredibly important, but limited in application. So guys, what do Lewis dot structures do well? They tell us the order that the atoms bond and the types of bonds that form, single, double, and triple. What they don't do is give us any idea about their three-dimensional structures. So to do that, what we're going to do is we are going to step into the third dimension. We're going to figure out what these molecules actually look like three-dimensionally, but to do that, we got to talk terms first, and this is where you start taking notes. You ready? So guys, the first term that you need to know, and get this in your notes, you'll notice there's a place for this. Guys, the first term that you need to know is electron domain. So guys, what does the word domain mean? So if you're watching PBS specials, and it's not wrong to admit publicly that you watch Channel 7. Okay, so you're watching PBS, you're watching a nature show, and the guy gets on there in really hushed tones and he says, "We are now entering into the domain of the lion." And they're out in the Serengeti and they're talking. So guys, what does it mean when we talk about the domain of a lion? What does that mean? It's just the place where lions live, right? Yeah, not tough. So guys, when we talk about domains, what we're talking about is the places where things can be found. So if you're in the domain of a lion, you're probably going to find lions. So if you're in the domain of an electron, what are you probably going to find? Electrons. So guys, electron domains are the spaces that electrons occupy around the nucleus of an atom. But guess what? You already know about electron domains. You've been counting them for the last 2 days. What have we been calling electron domains? Shared pairs and lone pairs. Guys, you didn't even know it, but when you were counting shared pairs and lone pairs around the central atom, what you were actually counting is electron domains. If you've got a shared pair, that's a bond. There are electrons there. If you've got a lone pair, that's two electrons that aren't bonded. You've got electrons there. Those are the electron domains. But guys, there's one little difference, and you need to write this down. Not this down. I'm sort of setting the stage. So here's what we know. There can be bonding domains and non-bonding domains. So let's go bonding domains first. And this is where you've got space in your notes to write this down. See where it says bonding domains? And then down below that, there's a little tick mark. So guys, that's where you can write this down. Bonding domains are shared pairs. Are you going to run that to Karen? Did you write the number on the top? It's 01359. What? It still has to have the card number on it, though. Yeah, so it's just 01, sorry. It's 01359. Bah! Go with that one. Don't worry, we are recording. Oh, now everybody's going to know my card number. Disregard that. 01359. Got it? All right. 0, 1, 3. All right. Niner. All right. So guys, bonding domains are the shared pairs. But here's the thing that's a little different. You can continue to write this out to the right. Guys, any bond type counts as one domain. This is the only part that makes this a little bit tricky. You guys already know how to count shared pairs. But it turns out that any number of shared pairs is one domain. And guys, I know that doesn't make a ton of sense right now, but it will in just a minute when I show you an example. Okay, so those are bonding domains. Now let's go non-bonding domains. Guys, non-bonding domains are the lone pairs. So now let's make sure all of this makes sense. You ready? Draw this with me. You'll notice that there's a big space in your notes where you can draw a diagram. Draw this diagram. Guys, these are the four types of domains. These are the four places where we find electrons. We find electrons in lone pairs. We find electrons in single bonds. We find electrons in double bonds. And we find electrons in triple bonds. And each one of those counts is one domain. Guys, it doesn't matter how many lions are in the Serengeti, it's still one domain. It doesn't matter how many electrons are in a domain. It could be two, it could be two, it could be four, it could be six. It doesn't matter, it's still one domain. Do you get the idea? You thinking you understand what electron domains are? Questions right now. Okay, guys, and let's prove it. Can I go on? Okay, so let's try this. Remember, don't write this down. Remember this molecule? You got to memorize it, right? Okay, so guys, watch this. Keep your eye on this carbon right there. Please don't blurt anything out. Let people think about it. But guys, the question you should be able to answer is how many domains are on that carbon? Hold on. But how many domains are on the carbon? Have you had a chance to think about it? How many domains are on that carbon? Four. You okay? So guys, we've got single bond, single bond, single bond, single bond. Each of those is a domain. Four domains. Okay? All right. So now guys, try this one. Again, same question. Let people think. How many domains are on this carbon? So how many domains are on that carbon? Is it three or is it four? It's three. So guys, here we have a domain with two electrons. Here we have a domain with two electrons. Here we have a domain with four electrons, but it's still just one domain. So this would be one, two, three domains. Does that clarify what it means that any type of bond counts as one domain? Okay, so now guys, what about the oxygen? Same question. How many domains are on that guy? Go ahead. Is it four or two? It's four. So guys, we've got one domain, two domains, because unbonded electrons are a domain. So one, two, three, four. Four domains? You're good? Okay, so what about the oxygen at the top? How many domains are on that? Three domains. So guys, we've got one here, and then that double bond is one domain for a total of three. So now guys, let's answer questions, because you've got to be able to count domains to be successful today. What questions do you have about identifying and counting domains? You're really okay? All right. So now, guys, we're going on to thought number two. And it is what we call Vesper theory. Obviously, this is an acronym, right? So here's what it stands for. Oh, wait. You know what? Hold on. I got to fix this. It stands for the valence shell electron pair repulsion theory, but I got so excited bolding and underlining letters that I did it to the T in theory, and it's not even in the acronym. So it's time to fix that. All right, here we go. So bold, underline, ha, fixed it. There we go. All right. Yes. Yep. So guys, thought number two is this. Thought number one, what are electron domains? You're telling me that you understand because you're not asking questions. Thought number two has to do with this thing called Vesper theory, the valence shell electron pair repulsion theory. Now guys, this sounds really fancy, right? The valence shell electron pair repulsion theory. But guess what? If you understand what these words mean, you should be thinking in your mind, duh, kind of already knew that. So guys, let's pick this apart. Guys, valence shell electrons, where are those? On the outside. And when they exist in pairs, what do we call them? Domains. And what do these valence shell electron domains do? They repulsion. Guys, why would these domains repel each other? They're the same charge and they want to get away. So guys, if you understand this, you should be thinking to yourself, no kidding. Because guys, all it's saying is that valence shell electron pairs, domains, repel each other. That's all Vesper theory says, is electron domains repel each other. That's it. So now, guys, we've got two thoughts. Thought number one, what is an electron domain? Thought number two, what do these domains do to each other? And the answer is, they get away from each other. So now the question is this, why do we care? Well, guys, the reason that we care is because this repulsion causes them to get as far away from each other, and that's what determines their three-dimensional shapes. As these electrons repel, they push into three dimensions, they try to spread out, and as they spread out, they take on these interesting three-dimensional shapes that you're about to learn about. This isn't for a while, but there you go. All right, guys, we've now done two of the three things that you need to know up front. Thing number one, what are domains? Thing number two, what do domains do to each other? And you now understand they repel and they're trying to spread out as much as they can. So guys, any questions over thoughts one and two? You're sure you're good? You ready for thought number three and then we're gonna flip the paper over? Okay, here we go. Guys, thought number three is back to this idea of electron domains, and it turns out that these electron domains are not all the same size. You don't need to write this down. You need to write down what the domains look like, and you'll notice that I've given you space to do that down here. So guys, these domains do not look the same. Bonding domains do not look the same as non-bonding domains. So guys, bonding electron domains, and you have a place to write this in your notes, bonding electron domains are long and skinny. So guys, let's talk about why. Imagine that this rubber band is an electron domain. So in here we've got electrons. Now guys, now imagine that my thumbs are the nuclei of two atoms. And if these atoms are bonded together, remember the animation that I showed you on the board where they fight over electrons? Guys, when these two nuclei fight over electrons, it stretches out the domain. The nuclei are pulling in opposite directions, and it stretches the electron domain out. Can you picture that? So bonding electron domains are long and skinny because they are experiencing the pull of two different nuclei. So guys, you don't have room to draw this down below. You may want to draw it off to the right. But guys, this is literally what a bonding electron domain looks like. This is what long and skinny looks like. You know what I want to do though? No, you don't know what I want to do. I can't, never mind. I was going to move it over there where you're taking notes. But I can't. So there you go. So guys, you may want to draw this off to the right. So when we say long and skinny, the blue is the rubber band and it's being elongated because of the pull of these two nuclei. Does that sit okay? Are y'all caught up? Okay. So now guys, let's talk about non-bonding electron domains. Guys, if a non-bond, well, let me ask it differently. So how many nuclei are going to be pulling on a non-bonding domain? Only one. It isn't bonded. That's the point. So guys, non-bonding electron domains are short and fat. The reason that they're short and fat is they're only being pulled on by one nucleus. Sometimes I can do this, sometimes I can't. Oh, this isn't bad. So guys, remember, my thumb is the nucleus, right? And now this is a non-bonding domain. Notice it's not a bonding domain. It's not being elongated. It's a non-bonding domain. And as this nuclei pulls, it makes that domain short and fat rather than long and skinny. So this is a short, fat domain because there's only the pull of one nuclei, and it looks more like this. So guys, as you're catching up with your notes and your drawings, let's review. First thing we learned is what an electron domain is. Then we've proved to ourselves that we could identify them by looking at that vinegar molecule and counting domains. Then guys, the second thing that we learned was that these domains vesper, they push on each other, they spread out as much as they possibly can. And then the third thing that we just learned is that all domains do not look the same. Bonding domains are long and skinny, non-bonded domains are short and fat. You guys three for three? Because if you're caught up with that and feeling good about it, we're gonna flip these over and get into the interesting stuff. You guys good? You sure? Okay, flip them over. Here we go. So guys, we are now going to let you in on the secrets. by understanding electron domains, by understanding they push on each other, and by understanding that they don't have the same sizes and shapes, we're now going to give you the decoder key that you're going to need in order to figure out what these molecules actually look like. Now, guys, not literally, but mentally, hold this paper at arm's length and sort of get a sense for how it's organized. So, guys, what does your eye pick up on as you just sort of glance through the back of this paper? Okay, good. So there's a repetition to this, right? That we've got three tables. These tables are repetitious. But what do you notice about the difference between the tables as we go top to bottom? They got smaller. It goes from 4 to 2 to 1. It actually is halves. You'll see why in a minute. But guys, what about this? Now allow your eye to look for organization. And guys, how do we pick up, what do we notice when we look for organization? Headers. And guys, you'll notice that I put these in bold so that they stand out. So how is the back of this table organized? By the number of electron domains. Now stop right there. What are electron domains? Remember, you just learned it, right? So guys, what you're going to find out is that all of this information is organized by the number of electron domains in decreasing order. So the first thing we're going to do is talk about molecules that have 4 domains. Then we're going to talk about molecules with 3 domains. Then we're going to talk about molecules with 2 domains. Does that make sense? Okay. So guys, this is how then we're going to get started. Don't write this down. So, question. And we're always going to start each of these sections with a question. So guys, I'm going to pose the question to you and see if you can come up with the answer. So guys, the question goes like this. When 4 objects are spread around a central point in 3-dimensional space, what angles are created if these objects are as far apart as possible? So guys, let's link this question back to what you learned on the other side of the paper. So guys, first of all, what are our 4 objects going to be? Domains. Okay? So we are going to understand that these 4 objects are domains. So what then is our central point going to be? The atom that's in the middle. Now what about this? Why do we care that these things are spread as far apart as possible? Because of Vesper theory. Vesper theory tells us that they spread as far apart as possible. So guys, we're going to talk about this hypothetically, then we're going to apply it to atoms. Now here's the tricky bit. You got to understand, we've got to think about this in terms of 3 dimensions. So guys, check this out. If you don't understand what the question is asking, consider this. So this is our central point. In a minute, you're going to understand that's the central atom. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do this. I'm going to surround this central point with 4 other points, and I'm going to spread them out as much as possible. So here we go. Here's point number 1. So where am I going to put point number 2 to spread it out as much as it can? Right over here, right? So now when I place point number 3, where does point number 4 have to go to spread out as much as possible? Down below, right? Okay, so now let's answer the question. What are the angles? So we draw in the lines, and what are the angles that are created now that these are spread out as much as possible? What are these angles? 90 degree angles, right? So guys, the answer to this question appears to be 90 degree angles. So when we spread 4 objects around a central point, what are the angles that are created if they're spread out as much as possible? 90 degrees. Except for one really big problem. It's not 3-dimensional. Guys, if we lived in a two-dimensional world, which I think would be a wonderful theme for a book, if we lived in a two-dimensional world, the answer to this would be 90 degrees. But we live in a three-dimensional world. And guys, in a three-dimensional world, the answer is not 90 degrees. So let me give you the answer. There's a place for you to write this in your notes. Guys, the answer is actually 109.5 degrees. So now you're going, wait a second. It looks to me like this should be 90 degrees, and now you're telling me it's 109.5 degrees. What on earth is going on? Well, guys, the problem is you need to start thinking three-dimensionally. You get it? What's the connection? Guys, what does this stupid collection of straws and paper clips have to do with the question on the board? First of all, it's three-dimensional. What else? It's got four corners. One, two, and then the other two, three, four. So guys, this thing is a representation of the question that's on the board. We've got one, two, three, 4 points, and it's three-dimensional. So if that's true, where is the central point? Do you see that it's right there in the middle? Okay, now here's the thing you've got to understand before we get into this. So this is three-dimensional, this has got 4 points. But the other thing that has to be true of this is these 4 points have got to be spread out as much as they possibly can be. So guys, when I built this thing, what did I do to assure that these 4 points are spread out as much as they can be? All what? The straws. Guys, when I cut the straws, I just stacked up a bunch of straws and lopped them all off the same length. Because these straws are all the same length, these points are all a maximum distance apart. Do you get the idea? Okay. So, guys, with that said, let me show you a 109.5 degree angle. So, guys, inside this Tupperware, there is actually, let me get some paper towels. There's actually bubble juice that I've put a bunch of glycerin in to try to create more stable bubbles.
Oh my God.
Let me get rid of that. There we go. Oh, poop. We'll get it. There we go. That's why I moved your backpacks. I'm going to bring these out here and just make a mess. Oh, poop. No, we'll get it. We'll get it. First period's always hard because it doesn't have a bunch of bubble juice on it. Okay, here we go. So, guys, now all of a sudden you can see that these are not 90-degree angles. That the film that is connecting these points, if I pop my peas, I blow out the bubble. Ooh, look at this. Oh, nuts. We'll get it. Have no fear. Okay. So guys, we can clearly see that these are not 90 degree angles. That if this is our central point and these 4 points are our domains, if we spread these out as much as possible and connect them in the easiest possible way. And how do we know that these are being connected in the easiest possible way? Because bubble film is very weak, and by definition, it will connect these points the easiest possible way. We can see that that angle is greater than a 90 degree angle. And in fact, if we could measure it, although gravity is making it sag a little bit, if we could measure that angle, we would find out that it's actually a 109.5 degree angle. So in three-dimensional space, it's not 90, it's 109.5. You get the idea? Okay, so guys, be careful. When you leave today, this stuff remains slick for a really long time, so don't slip as you're leaving. But guys, are we now convinced that it's not a 90 degree angle and it is in fact a 109.5 degree angle? Is that okay? Okay, so guys, let me offer you this then. We've seen it with red straws and bubble film, but guys, in reality, it looks like this. This is a molecule that contains these 4 points spread out in three-dimensional space. And we can now see here as well that these are 109.5 degree angles. So guys, what we've got to do now is we've got to name this thing. So let's come up with the name. Do you see where this is going to go in your notes? So guys, what is the mathematical, if you will. What is the prefix for four in math? Quad, but there's another one. So, guys, we are going to choose tetra. And this four-sided structure we call a tetrahedral structure. Okay, so now, guys, with that established, you'll notice as you allow your eye to scan down, we now get into this table, right? Well, guys, what you're going to find out is that there are a lot of different molecules that start with a tetrahedral structure. But it turns out that many of them don't end up tetrahedral. So, guys, go to this table and let's talk about this. So here's the same table that you have in front of you. Now, what do all these molecules, what are they all going to have in common? They're all going to have four electron domains. But you're going to find out in a minute, that doesn't mean that they all look the same. So guys, these are the examples that we're going to do. Hey, we're going to do CH4, write these down, NH3, H2O, and HF. Now guys, here's the trick. There's a method to my madness. Guys, you've done all of these in homework over the last 2 days. So I feel totally comfortable going like this and giving you their Lewis dot structures because you've already drawn them. I just don't want to have you fish them out of your homework. You bet. You guys like the bubble thing? You know you can actually get a PhD in soap bubbles? Yeah, some of the most phenomenal math that is being done right now is actually the math of describing soap bubbles. It's really cool. It's a mathematical degree. Yeah, it's pretty cool. I actually have a friend at church that teaches at BYU in the math department, and it's his research emphasis is soap bubbles. It's cool. Yeah. All right, you guys all caught up with me? Okay, guys, don't miss this next thought. This is important, and if you don't understand this, this could get weird. Guys, ask yourself this question. What do these four molecules all have in common, and the answer is not hydrogen? What do all four of these molecules have in common, given what we're talking about? They all have four domains. Guys, if you're not sure, 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yep. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. So guys, these all have four domains. That means right up here, they all have tetrahedral domain geometries. But what you're going to find out is they don't all look the same. So now we need to move to the right and figure out what they look like. So guys, starting with CH4, count the number of bonding domains on that central carbon. How many are there? Four. How many non-bonding domains? Zero. And guys, this is what this molecule looks like. One carbon, four hydrogens, all spread out in three-dimensional space. What are those angles? 109.5. And what are we calling this shape? Tetrahedral. So guys, the angle is 109.5, and the molecular geometry being what it actually looks like, is tetrahedral. So now you're going, wait a minute, I thought this was going to get different. Check this one out. Guys, NH3, count the bonding domains. How many? Three. How many non-bonding domains? One. So guys, this is what NH3 looks like if you could actually see a molecule. Now, what is missing? We've got the blue nitrogen. We've got the three white hydrogens. What is not represented in this model? The lone pair of electrons. But now, guys, mentally go back to your front of your notes. Don't flip it over, but go back there mentally. Guys, what do you know about this unbonded pair of electrons? What's its shape? Short and fat, right? You told me you understood that. So guys, check this out. Watch my fingers. Here's the deal. That short, fat pair of electrons right here is there. We don't represent it in the model, but it's there. And it is short and fat. And look at what it does. This short, fat pair of electrons pushes these down. You see that? So guys, what happens to that angle? Does it get bigger or smaller? It gets smaller. It actually goes down to 107 degrees. Okay, but you don't need to write down 107 in this box. Guys, 2 years ago, the AP authors decided that high school students do not need to know that this angle is 107. So we're going to do what the AP authors tell us, because a lot of you are coming back for AP next year. You just need to know the angle is less than 109.5. It actually is 107, but you just need to know that it's less than 109.5. Okay, now guys, check this out. Is this a tetrahedron? No, that's not a tetrahedron. Guys, this is a tetrahedron. This is what a tetrahedron looks like. This does not look like a tetrahedron. So we need to describe this molecule. So guys, check this out. Would you agree that it kind of looks like a pyramid? And how many legs does the pyramid have? Three. So this is what is called a trigonal pyramid. Got it? Okay. So now, guys, it's time to go down to our good friend water. How many bonding domains on water? Two. Well, not total domains. Bonding domains, there are two. How many non-bonding domains? Two. So guys, the molecule looks like this. I think a lot of you know that. Water looks like this. What is not represented in the model? Two short, fat, unbonded domains. And what is that? What are those? What are these unbonded domains going to do to the molecule? Close these angles down even more. Actually closes them down to 104.5 degrees. That you don't need to know that. That is actually the bond angle in water, though. It's 104.5. All that you need to know is, again, less than 109.5. So now, guys, we got to name it. Four tetrahedral, three trigonal pyramid. What are we going to name the molecular structure of water? No, it's actually really disappointing. We actually just call it bent. Yeah, I know. I know. It's sort of a letdown. Okay, so now, guys, we've got the last one to go. Looking at the fluorine, how many bonding domains on fluorine? One. How many non-bonding domains on fluorine? Three. Guys, the molecule looks like this. Again, what is not represented? One, two, three unbonded electron pairs. So guys, let's talk about this molecule because this is weird. First of all, the angle. What is the angle in this molecule? There isn't one. Guys, understand from geometry, if you've got two points do not define an angle. What do they define? A line. And guys, lines do not have angles. So the angle is undefined. There is not an angle. So if there is not an angle, what are we going to call this structure? And we call it straight. Okay, so guys, here's the deal in summary. You ready? What do all these molecules have in common? They all have four domains. You need to be able to identify that that means they have a tetrahedral domain geometry. But notice, guys, that only one of these molecules actually looks like a tetrahedron. So CH4 looks like a tetrahedron. This looks like a trigonal pyramid. This is bent and this is straight. So you also need to be able to figure out their molecular geometries, and their molecular geometries are based on the number of bonded and non-bonded domains. You get the idea? Okay. So guys, what's down here is just a summary of what we just said. Let's go to three domains. You ready? Same question. When three objects are spread in three-dimensional space around a central point, spreading them out as far as we possibly can, what are the angles that are created? Well, let me show you the picture. I'm going to put 1 point here, 1 point there, 1 point there. Those are spread apart as far as they possibly can be. We connect them with lines. What are the angles? Come on, gang, what are those angles? 120 degree angles. Now, let's think three dimensions. If we cast this into three-dimensional space, what do those angles do to spread out even further? Nothing. They're as far apart as they can be. So guys, the answer to this question is the same in two- and three-dimensional space. The angle is 120 degrees. Now we need a name for this. So guys, to name this, let me show you a molecule. This is number one out of yesterday's homework. Remember when we started the day with this? This is the connection. One, two, three domains. So guys, the idea is this. We've got 3 points, so what's the prefix we're going to use? Tri. But now guys, watch this. Do you see if I turn it this way that this little bugger's flat? Which means it's all in the same plane. So guys, this molecule is what is called trigonal planar. All right, here we go. So guys, from here, we are now ready to fill out our table, and we are going to look at three electron domain structures, and there's two of them that you need to know. And again, you've done these already. CH2O, which was number one out of the homework we graded today, and then NO2, and guys, their Lewis dot structures look like this. Just write them down. Are you good? You okay? Bless you. You guys all caught up? All right, I'll zoom out. Okay, so guys, here we go. Again, what do these molecules have in common? They all have three domains. One, two, three, one, two, three. So they have three domains on their central atom. So now let's figure out what the molecules look like. So guys, looking at CH2O, how many of these three domains are bonding domains? How many of these three domains are bonding domains? All three. Single bond, double bond. There are three bonding domains. How many are non-bonding domains? Around the central atom, none. So guys, we've already looked at this molecule before. Let's do it again. Here's what this thing actually looks like. And this is our example of 120 degree angles. And this thing is trigonal planar. So now, guys, let's go down to NO2 with a minus one charge. Guys, looking at the nitrogen in the middle of this molecule, how many bonding domains? You guys are scaring me. Two bonding domains, okay? It's just the central atom. So, guys, there's a bonding domain, there's a bonding domain. Now, how many non-bonding domains? One. So now, guys, let's look at it. We've got a double bond to an oxygen and a single bond to the oxygen. But again, guys, what's missing from the model? The unbonded pair of electrons in this short, fat, unbonded pair of electrons. What does it do to the other ones? Pfft, smushes them down. What does it do to that angle? Makes it smaller. All that you need to know is that it is smaller than 120 degrees. Now, guys, I'll bet you're picking up on this. What are we going to name this thing? Also bent. Okay, so now, guys, an interesting question. Why is there not a third row on this table that's one bonding domain and two non-bonding domains? No, they exist. There's lots of them. You'll see them in homework. Why didn't I put it on there? It's straight. Guys, anytime you have one bonding domain, you've only got two atoms. And when you've only got two atoms, it is undefined angle and straight. So I didn't put it there because I didn't need to, because anytime you have one bonding domain, it's undefined and straight. You get the idea? Okay, we got one more to go. So guys, it goes like this. Same question. Two objects around a central point. So there's one point. Where's the other point go? On the other side. Draw the line. What's the angle? 180. No, it's 180. This is not undefined because now we have three points, right? So guys, point, center point, point, that's a 180 degree angle. But guys, you'll notice they're all in a line. Huh? So what are we going to call it? Linear. Not straight. Guys, be careful with straight. Straight means no angle. Linear means 180 degree angle. The difference is linear's got 3 points, straight's only got two. So now, guys, let's look at an example. Our trusted friend, carbon dioxide. Looks like this. You've done this a couple times in homework already. I'll zoom into it. Did you get it? You okay? Okay, so guys, same game. How many domains on the carbon? How many domains on the carbon? Two. So that means it's got two electron domains. It's got a linear domain geometry. But how many of those domains are bonding domains? Two. How many are non-bonding domains? Zero. So guys, what's the angle going to be? Well, let's take a look. Check this out. This is what carbon dioxide looks like. There's your 100 and double bonds. There's your 180 degree angle, and this thing is all in a line. So it's 180 degrees, and we call this molecule linear. Now guys, once again, just to be clear, why is there not, oops, sorry, it didn't get it, 180 degrees and linear. So guys, just to be clear, why is there not a line that has one bonding and one non-bonding? It's straight and undefined. Every time there's only one bonding domain. You guys good? Okay. So, guys, this then is what you're going to do with this. Don't try to write this down with me. But, guys, let me show you how this is going to play out in homework. So, these are just, okay. So, these are the directions for your homework today. Draw the Lewis dot structures for these molecules, just like you've been doing for the last 2 days. But then it says this. You're no longer counting shared and lone pairs. What you're now doing is identifying the domain and molecular geometries and identifying the central atom, the angle around the central atom. So I'm going to show you three examples. Here are their Lewis dot, here are their Lewis dot structures. I clicked one too many. So it's going to go like this. Boom, boom, boom. Okay. So you're going to draw their Lewis dot structures. But then, guys, domain, molecular geometry, and angle. So here's how you do this. Grab your homework or your note sheet, keep it on the back, and here we go. Guys, look at that central atom. How many domains are on the central atom? 1, 2, 3, 4. So if there's 4 domains, what's the domain geometry? Tetrahedral, right? Here at the top. Tetrahedral. So for domain geometry, you're going to write down tetrahedral. Now you need to know the molecular geometry. How do you figure out which ones of these it is? What are you going to count? Bonding domains. How many of these domains are bonding domains? 1, 2, 3. So if 3 of them are bonding domains, what's the molecular geometry? Trigonal pyramid. And what's the angle? Less than 109.5. That's what you're going to be doing in homework. So now, guys, let's do this. Uh-oh, which atom is the central atom? Doesn't matter. So let's pick the one on the right because it's closer to me. How many domains are on this oxygen? Come on, gang. How many domains? 1, 2, 3. So if there's 3 domains on the oxygen, what is the domain geometry? Do you guys really not understand this? 3 electron domains, trigonal planar domain geometry, yeah? Okay, now to figure out the molecular geometry, you're going to count the bonding domains. How many of these are bonding domains? Just one. But wait, there isn't a place that says one bonding domain. It's because you know it's straight and undefined. Yeah? Okay, so this would be a trigonal planar domain geometry, a straight molecular geometry, and an undefined angle. So now, guys, let's do this one. Look at the carbon. How many domains are on the carbon? Two. So what's the domain geometry? Two domains is linear. Now what's the molecular geometry? How many of these domains are bonding domains? Two. So that means the molecular geometry, also linear. What's the angle? 180. You get the idea? Okay. So guys, with that said, here's the deal. When you take the test on Tuesday, you will not have this available to you. You have to memorize these. So let's have this conversation first. Guys, every year I catch people cheating on this test. They decide somewhere up in some deep dark recess of their brain that rather than actually spend the time to learn these, it's easier to just write them down on a piece of paper, tuck them underneath their thigh as they're getting ready for the test, pull it out and cheat on the test. So guys, here's the deal. When you take this test, you are going to sign an honesty statement that says, I did not do anything on this test to compromise my integrity while I was taking it. And you're going to sign that. I have no idea why that helps, but we've seen the incidence of cheating decrease because apparently some of you are idiots, but moral idiots, and if you sign your name... If you sign your name, you actually have this crisis. I don't know why that works, but apparently it does. But guys, with all of that said, have you figured this out? You don't have to memorize hardly any of this. So guys, check this out. If you've got four domains and they're all bonding, what's true of the domain in molecular geometries? They're the same. If you've got three domains and they're all bonding, they're the same. If you've got two domains and they're all bonding, they're the same. So guys, if you have all bonding domains, the domain and molecular geometries are the same. That cuts your memorization down by about a third. So what about the ones that are straight? Well, anytime you've got one domain, it's always straight. So now you picked off three more. Now, what about the ones that have two bonding domains? Well, if it starts with more than that number of domains, it's always bent, right? So if it's four domains, two are bonding, it's bent. If it's three domains and two are bonding, it's bent. So guys, if you can find ways to compress this in your brain, it's really not that much to memorize. You just need to spend the time to do it. So guys, with that said, let's look at homework. We are done. So looking at your homework, assignment five, right? The very back of the packet. Five, four, five, four, five, and number four. So guys, here's the deal. On assignment number five, I've given you all the same examples in number four. How you choose to take advantage of that is up to you. If you believe that you are very proficient at drawing Lewis dot structures, I don't believe it would be inappropriate to go back to assignment number four using the Lewis dot structures you've already drawn, simply put in the domain molecular geometries and angles. Now, if you know, whether you choose to admit it or not, if you know that you are not good at drawing Lewis dot structures, you would be a fool to go back to assignment number four. You need more practice. So do assignment number five as if you've never seen them before, because you haven't. You haven't memorized them. Do them again. But guys, that's up to you. All we're going to grade on Friday is just your names and angles. Okay? If you need more practice, do them all over. If you think you're okay, we'll see you on the test on Tuesday. Because if you choose to do it the other way, that's up to you. You guys good? So we've, holy, really? Yeah, so we've got almost 15 minutes. I can be done with this in 15 minutes. I'll bet you could too.